I think, well, there's several questions there. One is about the discussion of the United States, and I think what I said is approximately what you said, except I didn't use some of that rhetoric. Which I don't particularly think is particularly helpful to tell you the truth, either analytically or to understand or whatever, but it's the same picture. John Jay had it straight. The people who own the country ought to govern it, and the people who own the country have basically now are a network of corporations and conglomerates and banks and so on. They ought to govern it, and the way they do it is by the methods we've described. Now, as far as the Soviet Union is concerned, I didn't happen to talk about it tonight, but I've written about this topic. I haven't just made the charge. I've written about it and explained why I think it's true. And it doesn't bother me if I happen to agree with the mainstream media on this. Trotsky, to pick somebody who you remember, once he was charged in the 1930s with agreeing with the fascists in his condemnation of the Soviet Union. And he pointed out that his critique was to be true. He wasn't going to abandon it if somebody else had to happen to say it for different reasons. So the question is about the Soviet Union, and particularly about Lenin. So what was Leninism? Well, in my, here we have to look at the facts. Now, you know, you look at the facts, I think here's what you find. Lenin was a right-wing deviation of the socialist movement, and he was so regarded. He was regarded as that by the Marxists, by the mainstream Marxists. We've forgotten who the mainstream Marxists were because they lost, and you only remember the guys who won. But if you go back to the to that period, the mainstream Marxists were people like, for example, Anton Panikov, who was head of education for the Marxist movement, and a serious, he's the one of the people who Lenin later denounced as an infantile leftist. But he was one of the leading intellectuals of the actual Marxist movement. Rosa Luxemburg was another mainstream Marxist, and there were others. And they were very critical. In fact, Trotsky was one up until 1917. They were all very critical of Leninism because of this, what they regarded as this opportunistic vanguardism, the idea that the radical intelligentsia were going to exploit popular movements to seize state power and then to use that state power to whip the population into the society that they chose. Now, that was quite inconsistent with Marxism as understood by the mainstream sort of, I'd say, left Marxists. From this point of view, Bolshevism was a right-wing deviation. Trotsky made the same points up till 1917. Now, when Lenin came back to Russia in April 1917, he took a different line, quite a different line from the one he'd had in the past. There, you take a look at Lenin's work, it shifted character in April 17. In April 1917, it became kind of libertarian. That's when he came out with the April Theses, and that's when he wrote State and Democracy. It came out a year later, but that's when it was written. And these were State and Revolution. These were basically libertarian works. They were very much more in the mainstream of sort of left libertarian socialism, from sort of, you know, this range that goes from anarchism over to left Marxism of the Panikov-Luxemburg variety. And he talked about Soviets and the need for, you know, a workers' organization and so on. And in fact, came really closer to what the essence of socialism was always understood to be. After all, the core of socialism was understood to be workers' control over production. That was the core. That's where you begin with. Then you go on to other things. But the beginning is control by the workers over production. That's where it begins. Then Lenin took power in October 1917 in what's called a revolution, but in my view ought to be called a coup. And things followed that coup, or revolution if you want to call it that. One of the things that followed it was the immediate moves to destroy the Soviets and the factory councils. Those were some of the first moves of Lenin and Trotsky after they took, Trotsky joined at that point, after they took state power. In fact, if you look at what Lenin wrote after that period, or did, you'll find it's a reversion to the earlier position. This sort of left deviation is that, a deviation. You could ask why. In my view, it was just opportunistic. He knew that in order to gain power, he was going to have to go along with the popular currents that were developing, which were, in fact, spontaneous and libertarian and socialist, as most popular movements are, have been, in fact, since the 17th century. And being an astute politician, which he was, he sort of went along with that and talked the line that the people wanted to hear. It's just like when an American politician goes somewhere and his pollsters tell him, say so-and-so, and he says it, meaning believes it. And I think Lenin was doing the same thing without polls. In any event, whatever your interpretation is, when he took power, he reverted to the former vanguardism and moved at once to eliminate the organs of workers' control. Now, that meant he was moving to destroy socialism, if socialism has as its core workers' control over production. The Soviets and the factory councils were instruments of workers' control, and same, you could say they're defective instruments, and they worked out better and so on, yeah, no doubt. But they were the instruments that had been developed in the course of popular struggle to implement basically workers' control, and those were the first things to go. By early 1918, this is still really before the Civil War set in, Lenin's view was pretty clearly expressed. It was the view that both he and Trotsky took the position that what you need is what Trotsky called a labor army, which is submissive to the control of a single leader. He said modern, you know, progress and development and socialism requires that the mass of the population subordinate themselves to a single leader in a disciplined workforce. Well, that has absolutely nothing to do with socialism. In fact, it's the exact opposite of it. And was criticized for that by the, in a sense, in a spirit of some solidarity, because the revolutionary forces were still operative. He was criticized for that by people like Rosa Luxemburg and by Panikuk and Gorter and the other mainstream sort of left Marxists. And I think they were right. It seems to me that, and then it just goes on from there. I mean, Lenin reconstructed the czarist systems of oppression, often more efficiently, Cheka, KGB, and other techniques of control and oppression. I think from that point on, there was nothing remotely like socialism in the Soviet Union. I think it was, in fact, in my view, it was a precursor of later forms of totalitarianism. Now, you know, you could, that's what I think happened, and I think that's what you discover if you look at the facts. Now, why is it called socialism? Well, I think I think that's complicated, and we should look at it. The Soviet Union calls it socialism, and you know, after they took control of they did take control pretty soon of most of the international socialist movement, because primarily of the prestige of having created something sort of socialism. Incidentally, just a side remark, Lenin remained, despite it all, a sort of an orthodox Marxist in many respects. And as an orthodox Marxist, he didn't believe that it was possible to have socialism in the Soviet Union. This was supposed to be up to his death, or, you know, shortly before his death, when he was still writing, you know, speaking lucidly, he kept the view that the Soviet revolution was a holding action. They would just kind of hold things in place until the real revolution took place in Germany, because the revolution, according to Marxist doctrine, was going to take place in the most advanced sector of modern industrial capitalism, you know, for all the reasons that you read about in Marx. That's where the revolution had to take place. Obviously, that wasn't the Soviet Union, so there couldn't be socialism there. It was just some kind of holding action. And that presumably gave some sort of justification for eliminating the socialist institutions. I don't think it's a real justification, but probably that was the internal justification. And again, in taking that view, he was in accord with the mainstream Marxist tradition. Well, after that comes the view that all of this is socialism. And why should the communist parties take that view? I think the reason is because they wanted to exploit the moral force of socialism, which was quite real. You know, it's kind of hard to remember that today. But at that time, it was very real. This was regarded as a progressive moral force, and by associating their own destruction of socialism with the aura of socialism, they hoped to gain credit in the working classes and other progressive sectors. Now, the West also identified that with socialism, and they did it for the opposite reason. They wanted to associate socialism with the brutality of the Russian state that undermined socialism. So what you had is that the two major world propaganda agencies, for their own quite different reasons, were claiming that this is socialism, that this destruction of socialism is socialism. And it's very hard to break out of the control of the world's two major propaganda agencies when they agree. They agreed for different reasons, but they basically agreed, and that then became doctrine and dogma. Well, I think people should ask whether that's true. Take a look back and see whether the moves that Lenin took and that Trotsky supported him in taking and that they both advocated had anything to do with socialism as it was understood by, say, in the Marxist tradition or in the left libertarian tradition. And I think the answer that you'll discover when you look at that is that they didn't. In fact, this was a destruction of socialist institutions. Well, you know, this may be true or it may be false, but if it's true, and I think the evidence pretty strongly supports it, then I don't see any reason why we shouldn't express that fact. And I certainly don't think that we should be deterred in expressing this fact if other people who's, you know, fascists or whatever, happen to condemn the Soviet Union, just for the same reasons that Trotsky mentioned in the 1930s.